Hello and welcome to this, the very last of our online communion services provided by St Luke's Church in Hawkinge, Kent during the coronavirus crisis. Hopefully we're all going to be able to throw away all our masks and regulations from the 19th of July onwards. So let's keep praying for that, shall we? Because it would be lovely to be able to live normal lives again. But what's going to replace this communion service online? Well, some good news for you is that we're going to have Rob's sermons online each week. They're going to be recorded as he gives them in the church during the service and put up shortly afterwards, so that even if you're unable to make the service, you can still keep in touch with what's going on at St Luke's and follow the sermons. Well, anyway, without much further ado, let's begin our service this morning by saying, grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And let's begin now by singing together. Stand if you wish and sing with us all. At the name of Jesus, every knee must bow and every tongue confess. At the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
I say it every week, but that's one of my favourites. But then I think they're all my favourites in one way or another. Now it's time for us to say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these, and on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ says to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all that labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul says. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the perfect offering for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Let us therefore draw near to him now in prayer and confess our sins in penitence and faith as we say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now we say together the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And now we come to this week's Bible readings, and we'll begin in prayer as we pray the Collect for this week, the fifth Sunday after Trinity. Let us pray. Merciful God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as pass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Creator God, you made us in your image that we may discern you in all that we see and serve you in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our readings for this week, for the fifth Sunday after Trinity. The first comes from the second letter of Paul's to the Corinthians, and we're going to read chapter 2, verses 2 to 10. That's the second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 2, verses 2 to 10, if you'd like to follow along in your own Bibles. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. But on my own heart behalf, I will not boast, except for my weakness. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions and calamities for the sake of Christ, for whenever I am weak, then I am strong." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. What incredible words there that we can remember when things are getting tough and we're feeling particularly weak. It's at those times that though we are weak, he is strong and we can trust him. Isn't that marvellous? You know, we need to remember that more and more in these days as life becomes exceedingly difficult, or increasingly difficult, I should say. Our second reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, and it's chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. That's Mark chapter 6, 1 to 13. Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that's been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offence at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honour, except in their hometown and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on 2 tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you, and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Now, before we join Rob in the church for this week's sermon, message from the Word of God, we're going to sing again. We're going to sing another one of my favourites. Oh, this is getting boring, isn't it? And the hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Thank you. Well, we'll come now to teaching on prayer and on the subject of the perseverance in prayer. And so I'm just going to pray first, and we're going to open the scriptures together. Father God, we thank you for all the teaching of Jesus, and we thank you for his teaching on prayer. And we ask that this teaching today will encourage us, strengthen us, and support us on our prayer journey. Bless us, we pray in it, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we begin in Luke chapter 11, where it begins, "One day Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he'd finished, one of his disciples said to him, 'Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples.'" And this is Jesus' response. And it's in two parts. Firstly, he says, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, give us each day our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we also forgive everyone who sins against us, and lead us not into temptation.'" So Jesus gives them then the sort of model prayer that he would like them to pray. And then the next thing he says, which is what we're going to focus on today, the very next thing that Jesus does after he's given them the model prayer is to talk about perseverance in prayer. You need to learn how to persevere in prayer. And he goes on and he tells this, what we regard really as kind of a humorous sort of little parable. He then said to them, "Suppose one of you had a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, because a friend of mine on a journey has come, and I've got nothing set before him.' And then the one inside answers, 'Don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children are with me in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, though, he will not get up and give him the bread because he is a friend. Yet because of the man's boldness, he will get up." Actually, the original text says perseverance. "He will get up and give him as much as he needs." And so Jesus then, after giving them this model, basically says, listen, prayer is all about breakthrough. It's all about breakthrough. We'll come to that later. And therefore, it's really important that you learn how to persevere in prayer until we reach the breakthrough. Now, all prayer, you know, is resisted. And there is spiritual resistance to prayer. And we might feel that when we're praying, our prayers are kind of bouncing off the ceiling. And we're praying against almost a locked door at midnight. But in that passage of scripture, there's a clue that the friend who comes at midnight is absolutely convinced that he will get some bread. And he's convinced he will do it if he keeps on knocking. It comes in verse 8, "But I tell you this, though he won't do it as a friend, if you keep knocking long enough, he'll get up and give you everything you want just because of your persistence." That's from the Living Bible. Jesus here, talking about a village neighbour, a man who opens his door to an unexpected guest late one night to find that his cupboards are bare. Now, it would be unacceptable to turn a neighbour away, so he sets out to find a friend and to ask him for bread. And the story, especially the reaction to the neighbour, would have been quite humorous to the people that at the time who are listening to the story. But the message that it has is really important. It's a really powerful message. Keep pounding on the door. In fact, Jesus goes on to say in verse 9, "So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you." Now, what the friend at midnight does is to overcome some of the great enemies of prayer. And we're just going to touch on those very briefly. The first enemy of prayer in this context is indifference. You see, he could have said, "Oh, it's not really that important. We can live with it. We can all eat in the morning, and we don't have to bother him at night tonight. I know it's been a long journey, but if we can just hold on, maybe for a few more hours, then we could all eat together, and that'd be fine, and I won't really be a problem then. It's not important to God. I'm sure we don't need to pray about this. I'm sure God expects us to live with certain things in our lives. And so there's almost this indifference about it. You know, you can't pray for everything, surely. You can't pray for healing for hay fever. Just take some antiseptic. So, this sense by which actually we don't want to bother God, and it's not really that important. And we actually can live with it, and therefore we should live with it, and we shouldn't keep pounding the door. He overcomes that. He says, actually, no. I don't want to live with this. I don't want to wait till the morning. I'm going to bring this to heaven. I'm going to bang on the door. And I know it sounds a little bit audacious. I'm going to bang on the door. And I'm going to ask that I don't have to live with this. That this doesn't have to continue as it is. And I'm going to keep asking until God tells me otherwise. The first thing he overcomes then is indifference. The second thing he overcomes is a sense of apathy. So it was late, he was tired, he would have got sluggish and tired, and he could have easily said, look, you know what? I know you probably would be generous enough to give me some bread, but I just can't be bothered. I can't be bothered to go over to the neighbour's house and sort of get him up as well. I can't be bothered to go to that meeting, that prayer meeting, because, you know, I've been to a lot of prayer meetings before, and I do go to the prayer meetings, but I just feel a little bit tired. I don't really feel like doing it now. I just can't pray now. And it just feels like when I'm praying, I'm really sort of struggling with it. It's like just like wading through treacle, so to speak. And so many things, interestingly enough, get in our way. And interestingly enough, when we start to pray, how much tiredness gets in our way. And you just sort of think, well, maybe I'll put it off. I'll go next week, or I'll pray in the morning. He doesn't do that. He overcomes that apathy and shows a willingness to plead his case. And thirdly, he overcomes defeatism. That feeling when you think, oh, there's no point in going over there. He's never going to give me what I need. It's too late now. I'm not going to pray. We prayed about it before. I kept praying about it. Nothing's changed. Anyway, why do I need to keep pounding the door for a single request? I don't think it's going to make any difference. We prayed so much before and nothing has happened. And it's so important that we don't get into that place of defeatism, apathy, and indifference. Because the man that comes at midnight has overcome all of those and is banging on the door, and he gets a breakthrough. And there are times when we need to do that. And it's very important when we get into a place where we are pursuing prayer. We must be sure that we know that it's the Lord's will. Now, sometimes we don't. Sometimes we're not sure. And I remember at times I was praying for something. I'd go for long sort of prayer walks, and I kept pounding on the door of heaven, so to speak. And as I was praying, this went on for a few weeks. Eventually, the Holy Spirit released me, if you like, from that prayer. And so as we are praying, we are looking to the Lord to release us from the prayer. Otherwise, we continue. Otherwise, we continue to press in. I remember being in a meeting once where we were together as church leaders, and we were praying over a specific issue. And as we prayed, we thought we might be there for a couple of hours. Actually, we started praying, and after about 20 minutes, something shifted. We just felt there was a kind of almost a spiritual shift took place. And I remember one of the church leaders looking up and said, "It's over. It's done. It's done." And we just knew it was. We just knew it was done. We thanked the Lord and had a cup of tea, because we had been released from that perseverance of prayer at that moment by just sensing something of the Lord. Now, the Lord will release us from intercessory prayer if we are, for example, praying for something that's contrary to his will, or if actually we've already reached breakthrough and we're already there. And it's very important for us to be able to say to the Lord, "Lord, help me to know when the door's opened or it's the wrong door that I'm pounding on. Help me to know that you still want me to persevere in prayer and not to not to change direction or give something, because we need to be able to listen as well. Because when we are seeking and we're knocking and we're asking, we are also looking to see whether this is the direction that the Lord wants us to move into. Now, if we haven't been released, if you like, in our intercessory prayer as we go forward, and we still aren't making much progress in our prayers, we might choose then to knock the door a little bit hard. And how do we do that? Well, how do we sort of up the ante? Well, one of the ways that we can do that is to get more people involved in prayer, because the spiritual authority of the body of Christ is greater than just one person. And also the presence of Jesus is manifest when there's more than two or three are gathered in my name, he says. And because of that, therefore we're able to receive more revelation from the Lord and more prophecy from the Lord as we go forward. So we can up the ante, certainly, when we increase the number of people praying. We can up the ante, if you like, when we start to fast as well as to pray. And we can up the ante by asking the Lord if there are people within the body of Christ who can come and join us. And it may be that there are intercessors, there are certain ministries that are very powerful for unlocking things or breaking things or breaking through in things. And we can invite the body of Christ to do that. I remember a family who were praying for their son. He was quite ill in hospital, and they just hadn't had breakthrough. And they prayed for a church, and they still hadn't had breakthrough. So they said, right, okay, we know of people, we haven't met them personally, but we know of people within the wider body of Christ, even the worldwide church of Christ, who have got powerful ministries and giftings and anointings in this area, and we're going to invite them to come and pray. In fact, one of them actually came in person and laid hands on their son and prayed, and there was a breakthrough. They became, if you like, the spearhead for the prayers that were going on. And so we can do that as well in the perseverance of prayer. So let's not give up praying. Let's not be apathetic and defeatist. Let's seek the Lord for that breakthrough. And let's continue to seek the Lord for that breakthrough with all that we have, and with all the strength, if you like, and the call of the body of Christ, unless the Lord release us from it, which we are always seeking for him to do. And we need to know that release corporately and collectively, because we don't want to be deceived. We need to make sure that as the body of Christ, we witness to that together. And it's this breaking through that's so important. I remember actually in listening to some of the journals of John Wimber, when he was on his way around some of the small fishing villages in the northwest of England. And there was a particular village that had been very resistant to the gospel. And people had gone in before and they hadn't had any breakthrough, and there'd been no real sort of conversions. And so he was on his way there, and he just had this sense by the Holy Spirit just to pause for 2 days. And they actually went and they camped in the woods for 2 days, and they prayed and they fasted for 2 days. And then after 2 days, he sensed, along with his intercessors, that there was a breakthrough, a spiritual breakthrough. He went into the village. He stood up in the town square, on the steps of the town square. He preached the gospel, and dozens of people for the first time in that village came to accept and to love the Lord. And so there was that sense by which he knew that some breakthrough had taken place, but it required the perseverance of prayer. And in that case, it actually required perseverance of prayer for them for 2 days. So be encouraged in your prayer. Be encouraged. Jesus is encouraging us to keep praying, strengthen our prayers, ask the Lord to release us if we're getting it wrong, and to continue to pray until we have the breakthrough and the victory that we so long to see in our lives and in the lives of those around us. Well, God bless you and keep you. And I pray that you be strengthened. I pray that you are encouraged in your prayer life, and that you are able then to see wonderful answers to prayer. Let's pray to finish. Father God, we thank you that you've given us this powerful weapon for the pulling down of strongholds, the prayer of the church. mighty in battle. And we pray, Father, that you encourage us and strengthen us in all of this, in all of our ways, as we go forward as intercessory prayer, as we pound on the door of heaven and asking, Lord, to overcome all the things that resist in prayer, and to have that expectation and faith that we will have breakthrough if it's in the will and purposes for us by you. And so, Father, we give that to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thank you, Rob, for that message. And don't forget, Rob's sermons will from now on be available online during the week. So don't forget to join him if you miss the sermon in church or you want to hear it again. And now it's time for us to say together the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now we come to that special part of our service where we come before the Lord in prayer. And so we begin by praying quietly on our own, remembering all the things that have passed this week and the things that concern and worry us and our friends that we might be concerned about. Let's offer them now to the Lord in a moment of silence, and then I'll lead us in a more formal prayer. Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your care and protection during the past months of the COVID-19 virus. We offer you our thanks that we have, as a church, been able to continue to meet online. And although separated from each other in our individual homes, we've been able to come together through the shared space of the internet. And we pray that the past months have enabled us to grow stronger in our commitment and love for you and your gospel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray again against the spirit of fear which possesses so many hearts today. Fear of COVID, and even fear of each other, that in joining together we might become infected. And we pray, Lord, that this will no longer prevent us from coming together as your church, not only to become again your worshipping body in this place, but to be about your mission of sharing the good news of Jesus that you have called each one of us to. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our church family here in Hawkins. Help us, we ask, to begin meeting again in person, refreshed and reinvigorated to serve you in this place. Renew and restore our friendships, we ask, and restore the years that the locust has eaten, according to your promise, and fill us again with your Holy Spirit, that we might be equipped for the challenges that lay ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, we pray for all those in our fellowship who are sick, struggling with the pain of bereavement, loneliness, and for those who simply feel unloved. Lord, fill them, we pray, with your love, and we ask that they may know your presence and experience your healing in their hour of need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we say together, teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labour and not to ask for any reward, save that of knowing that we do your will. Amen. And we conclude our prayers by saying together, Lord, in your mercy, we ask that you accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now as we prepare our hearts to gather round the communion table, let's stay in an attitude of prayer as we sing the following hymn, which is a prayer in itself. May the mind of Christ my Saviour.
The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. it is right to give thanks and praise. Father, we give you thanks and praise for your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you've created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. And so he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and of wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as you shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. And as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
Well, thank you, Rob, for sharing our last online communion with us this morning. And I hope we can all be together to share that in church very soon. We come now to our very last hymn, and I've chosen one that you may not be familiar with. I don't think it's one we have sung here at St Luke's, in my memory anyway, and I've been here for 11 years. But it's a hymn that I think is especially poignant this morning as we conclude these online services. And it certainly carries a sentiment that I would wish to convey to you personally. So it's a lovely tune. The words are great. Listen to the tune. And if you know it, join in. But let's sing this together if we can. God be with you till we meet again.
Thank you.
Well, I'm afraid that's it. The very last of our online communion services. You know, I'm going to miss you in the weeks ahead, and I'm going to miss preparing this service each week. But let's pray that as we begin life again after the coronavirus crisis, that the Lord will refresh and renew us, and in a way that it'll be a new beginning for us all, and that we will all come to know the Lord Jesus Christ in a new and refreshing way. Well, it's goodbye from me, and I hope that one day we'll meet again perhaps. Until then, may God richly bless you in your life in the week ahead. Goodbye.